माला सुधा कुंभ विबोध मुद्रा विद्याविराजत करवारी जाता अपार कारुण्य सुधाम्बुरा शिमशी शारदाम्बां प्रणतोऽस्मि नित्यं शंकारूपेण मर्चित्तं पंकीकृतमभूत्यया किंकरीयस्य सामाया शंकराचार्यमाश्रये प्रह्लादवरदोदे भोजो नृसिंहः परो हरिः नृसिंहोपासकं नित्यं तं नृसिंह गुरुं भजे श्री सच्चिदानंद शिवाभिनव्य नृसिंहभारत्य पितान् यतीन्द्रान् विद्यानितीन् मंत्रनितीन् सदात्मनिष्ठान् भजे मानव शंभुरूपान् सदात्मज्ञाननिरतं विषयेभ्यः परान् मुखं नौमि शास्त्रेषु निष्णातं चंद्रशेखरभारती विवेकिनं महाप्रज्ञं धैर्योदारक्षमानितिं सदा विनवपूर्वं तं विद्यातीर्थगुरुं भजे अज्ञानां चान्नवीतीर्थं विद्यातीर्थं विवेकिनां सर्वेषां सुखतं तीर्थं भारतीतीर्थमाश्रये विद्याविनयसंपन्नं वीतरागं विवेकिनं वंदे वेदान्ततत्त्वज्ञं विदुशेखरभारती। Offer this humble talk at the lotus feet of Jyeshtha Mahasannidhanam Jagadguru Srimat Abhinava Vidyatheetha Mahaswamigal. Mahasannidhanam Jagadguru Shishi Bharatheetha Mahaswamigal and Sannidhanam Jagadguru Shishi Vidushekara Bharati Swamigal. Pranams to one and all. So happy to be here after almost 3.5 years. After the Vande Guru Paramparam series talk in 2017, when Dr. Vasumathi rang up to say that we are opening back after the post-COVID situation, I thought it's one of the best opportunities to be back at Tattvaloka, a hall which is engulfed with bliss and radiance of the Guru Parampara of the Shringeri Sharada Peetham. And it's so nice that we first had the Veda Kosham, which is capable of cleansing any intangible, invisible disorders in this world. That's the power of Vedas. And we only pray and wish with the divine blessings of Goddess Sharadamba and the efforts of so many people in different multiple ways, the world and India should be out of this disorder once and for all, so that all of us can resume our routines as we had prior to February 2020. Yesterday was a historic day in India, and the Honorable Prime Minister inaugurated or consecrated or installed the statue of Bhagavatpada Shankara at Kedarnath. It's of great significance because Jnananda Bharati Swamigal in its Thoughts of Gita had narrated how does an avatar emerge in this universe and why should an avatar emerge. Today happens to be also the Jayanti of Jnananda Bharati Swamigal, my Manasika Vedanta Guru. Because when I was struggling to learn Vedanta, I just prayed to him, went to his Adhishtanam, started reading it, remembering him and thinking about him, and he teaches me. That's the belief I have. So today happens to be his Jayanti, 132nd Jayanti of Jnananda Bharati Swamigal. He has said in Thoughts of Gita, see, let's imagine this universe, because we all believe in scientific proofs. How does lightning happen or thunder happen? When a negative cloud, means cloud charged with negative electricity power, electric power, and a cloud charged with positive electric power, when it collides, there emerges lightning followed by thunder. So it's part of the nature that when two opposite forces collide, something happens, emerges out of this universe. Likewise, whenever peak of adharma collides with dharma, when clashes it with dharma, that point of time would emerge avatara purushas, says our scriptures. So when two negativities, adharma colliding with dharma, results in the emergence of an avatara purusha. And that's what happened in the 8th century when 72 different ways of cults were prevalent. Bhagavatpada Shankara emerged and established the Amnaya Mats and finally disappeared in Kedarnath. And in his remembrance, a statue was consecrated yesterday. And you would have all seen the video, Mahasannidhanam and Sannidhanam. You would have all seen the video where Mahasannidhanam and Sannidhanam performing the pujas to Adi Shankara Bhagavatpada. And I refer this incident only for this reason. All of you who have watched it would have seen the bhakti performed by those Mahapurushas and Jivan Muktas. How they worshipped a name and form. We should start from there. And this was narrated only to derive and drive the way Mahasannidhanam prayed to Bhagavatpada Shankara, the way Sannidhanam prayed to Bhagavatpada Shankara. When we talk about Jeshta Mahasannidhanam, I've always placed reliance on the multifaceted Jivan Mukta to cite instances or cite any information because it's an encyclopedia on Mahasannidhanam, Jeshta Mahasannidhanam. You can't find any information left out in that text, because it is authored by Sri Umeshji. Now, we had the good fortune. We could all spend 2 full days of 2 hours each in 2017 to understand what this book says. And I thought that in 2017, well, what best is possible from the book, we could have said. But when I read it the 4th time or the 5th time now in 2020, we find that there is still so much of a treasure left out which can be unearthed and shared amongst the Sishyas. Keep dwelling on it. Keep digging on it. It unfurls treasure after treasure. And what is important is the bhavane between the Guru Swamigal and the Sishya Swamigal of this Peetam. We should understand that text first. And the bhavane they had, Jagadguru Srimad Chandrasekhara Bharati Mahaswami Hill was a Jivan Mukta. Jagadguru Srimad Abhinavidyatita Mahaswami Hill was also a Jivan Mukta. He attained it at the age of 18. Both Jivan Muktas, when they assumed the position of Guru and a Sishya Swami Hill, how do they interact? What do they display to the Sishyas of the world as to what we should all do as Sishya to our Guru? In his whole life, from 1917 to 1989, 72 years, 3 weeks are very, very important in the life history of Jeshta Mahasannidhanam. 3 weeks. 22nd May 1931 to 29th May 1931. His Sishya Srikaram took place on 22nd May. And that night, Shiva appeared in his dream. 7 dreams, one after the other. Seven consecutive nights, Shiva appeared and taught yoga. That's 1 week, critical. 5th December 1935 to 12th December 1935. Which we all narrated in the previous speeches, in 7 days, how from Savikalpa Samadhi to Nivilkalpa Samadhi and finally attaining the Jivan Mukta state, on 12 December 1935, within 4.5 years of assuming the sacred tomb. And the third crucial week is when he departed, attained the Videha Mukti between 16th September and the 21st September. So, when this encompasses the entire evolution of Jeshta Mahasannidhanam from a brahmachari to a sannyasi to a Jivan Mukta and how he spent the rest of his life. What was taught by his guru on his attainment of a Jivan Mukta state? The first important message was, you are a Jivan Mukta, which means you have dissolved your mind. There is no mind to register, to react, to feel the senses, to experience. There's nothing. It's gone. It's dissolved. So, how do you act as a Pitadhipadi to your Sishyas? You need to perform your duty as a Pitadhipadi. How do you do it? So, you can't be a hypocrite. You can't be pretentious to your Sishyas. You can't act in subterfuge. These are expressions used in the book. So, how should a Jivan Mukta, one who had attained the state of Jivan Mukta, still interact with his Sishyas in this world? Was one of the important lessons conveyed by Jagadguru Shrima Chandrasekhara Bharati Mahaswami held to Jeshta Mahasannidhanam. He advised, whenever there is a need, assume the mind. When there is a need, it's like whenever we want to wear a shirt, we wear it. Whenever we want to hang the coat, we hang it. So he conveyed, when you assume and sit in the petam to dispense compassion and guidance, assume the mind for that moment. Deal with the mind, whatever gets reflected, and give the guidance which Mata allows you to do it. Two, by doing this, the mind which is already burnt and dissolved will not get into any bondage. It's incapable of getting into any bondage. And three, once it can't get into a bondage, because there is no mind for it to register and keep store it, the question of becoming forgetful over a matter doesn't arise at all. All of us keep asking this question to our acharyas, one after the other. How do you remember this? You're able to recollect everything. What does our acharya say? We don't remember anything to forget. That is the answer they always give. The answer lies here. You wear a shirt, when you don't want, you hang it. So, if you do it in this way, you shall remain genuine in your guidance to your Sishyas. Look at the way what is being discussed, what is being guided and conveyed between the Sishya and the Guru in an Avichinna Guru Parampara. So this is one episode I thought I should narrate. The second interesting aspect is, even though Jeshta Mahasannidhanam attained the state of Jivan Mukta at the age of 18, he did not give up three things for quite some time. Swimming, climbing the trees, on walking long, long distances deep into the forest. Three transgressions. That's how Jeshta Mahasannidhanam perceives it. These are three transgressions I have made. So, Acharya twice attempted to convey and seek a pardon. Once in 1936, when Jagadguru Srimad Chandrasekhar Bharati Mahaswamigal, his guru, patted on his cheek and kept quiet. He wrote in 1940, no response. Then he again brings the subject for discussion in 1941 and says, these are three transgressions I make and I seek your pardon. For which his guru replied, I don't have to pardon you for this because these are three things which my guru liked and he did for quite a long time. See, the truth that is sought to be conveyed, when your guru does something, then when you become a guru and when your sishya does it something, you can't deal it differently. See the sink. So he says, there is nothing that I should do. I have understood one thing about these three transgressions. It's like you can't remove heat from fire. At least for some time, you cannot be without these three transgressions. I would accept this as a fact, change myself till such time you give it up. The third thing I thought I should cite from the book is the guidance to Jyeshtha Mahasannidhanam when his guru was in Bangalore and the Vidvat Sadas was happening in Shingeri, followed by the Navaratri festival. So when Jyeshtha Mahasannidhanam writes, one Jivan Mukta writes to another Jivan Mukta, please tell me what I should do during Navaratri. I would go by your guidance. A letter is sent, for which his guru replies, you shall do the following things during Navaratri. How to take care of your body. What pujas should be performed at what time. How you should take your bhiksha exactly at this time. How you should resume your evening pujas at what time. How you should visit the adhishtanam. A detailed letter is sent back as a reply. And Acharya concludes in that letter, when you go to the adhishtanams, chant Dakshinamurti Stotram. Chant Guru Parampara Stotram. Invoke the 10 messages of peace. It's all there in the book. Why should this be said, documented, and conveyed to us? What do we pick out of this? So when we go to the Adhishtanam next time, we should have read, understood, assimilated these three things. So when you go to the Adhishtanam next time, we should be in a position to chant the Dakshinamurti Stotra. It's a guidance given by a guru. What we should do before an Adhishtana. Guru Parampara Stuti. It's 47 slokas about the entire Guru Parampara. Starting from Narayana. And the 10 invocations of peace. When it comes to guiding the ordinary sishyas, there's a very interesting episode in the book. A Samaveda scholar goes to Shingeri. He's an expert Samaveda pandit. So he has the good fortune of having the darshanam of both the Jagadgurus, Jagadguru Srimad Chandrasekhara Bharati Mahaswamigal and Jagadguru Srimad Abhinava Vidyadhita Mahaswamigal together. Jyeshtha Mahasannidhanam was quite young at that point of time. So it ran into the mind of this Samavedic scholar. Look at the pity of the senior Swamigal. Oh God, such a young person. How difficult it would be for him to train him, to impart him so many things. What a strain it would be on the senior Swamigal. He's all thinking all this in his mind in the presence of both the acharyas. The senior acharya kept quiet for a minute. and asked the Samaveda Pandit to chant a particular portion of Samaveda. He couldn't chant it. He just couldn't chant it. And then Acharya said, I know what is running in your mind. Remember, Sishya Swamigal is being defended by Sharada Ambal, none other than Sharada Ambal. She will decide what senior Sishya Swamigal should be at some point of time. The Samaveda Pandit immediately prostrated and said, nothing wrong, I just wanted to guide you. Resume, now you say, and he chants. This is something which can very easily come into the minds of ordinary sishyas. Very, very easily. And this message is equally important to each one of us here present and one who may listen it a little later. When it comes to Guru Prasadam, Jyeshtha Mahasannidhan had, these are all very simple messages which each one of us can follow in our lives. The mahima, when a guru gives a prasadam, what it would mean to a sishya. So, a couple was losing heavily in their business. So, when they had the darshanam of the senior acharya, Jagadguru Srimad Chandrasekhara Bharati Mahaswami, he gave them a mango as a prasadam. Don't worry, things will become all right. And things started to become all right. Now the sishya, after consuming the mango, thought, I should not throw the seed because it's a prasadam. So let me sow it so that it grows into a mango tree and let it generate as many mangoes as possible. So with good intention, he sows the seed. Up came a mango tree, but without mangoes. So he went and presented his case before Jyeshtha Mahasannidhanam to say, I tried my best. This is Acharya's prasadam, but it still didn't happen. Then Acharya asks this question, have you taken care of the plant? First question, please see how he deals it. Did you consult a horticulturist to say, is there any problem with the plant? He just tested the Shishya Swamigal. Shishya Swamigal said, I have done all that, but I am sure this is a prasadam and therefore it has to fetch fruits. That's the answer the Shishya gave. He said, I will come to your house. So when he visits his house, Padabuji is performed. Everything is over. He says, show me the tree. And he takes water with him, holy water with him, and touches the tree, prays for a while, and comes back and tells the Shishya, this is a seed sown with faith and this is a prasadam given by my guru. This has to fetch, it reap its fruits and you will get it. And it started fetching mangoes thereafter. Which the Sishya says, I took it back to Sringeri, offered it to Acharya, and Acharya said, distribute it to those whomsoever you want here. Faith, the intensity of faith gives you back the rewards in multiple times. Intense faith. Service to the guru. What did Jyeshtha Mahasannidhanam do to his guru? He did so many things. One of them being, all of us knew the text of Viveka Chutamani authored by Jagadguru Srimad Chandrasekhara Bharati Mahaswamigal was something very unique. Jyeshtha Mahasannidhanam has typed the whole script himself and gave it to Sri Ramachandra Shastrikal, and then it was later released into a book, says Multifaceted Jeevan Mukta. When senior Acharyal stayed in the Durgambal temple over a night after the Rathotsavam, two of the usual guards who were to keep guard of the Acharyal felt it extremely cold. It was too cold then. So one of them returned to the boiler room, said, I will better lodge myself here. After a while, he wakes up and goes up and tumbles upon somebody And to his utter shock and surprise, he finds Jeshta Mahasannidhanam guarding his senior Acharya in Durgambal temple to ensure nothing happens to him. The relationship was too intimate and too intense in the case of any Shishya and any Guru Swamigal of this Peetam. Small things, very, very small things. Jeshta Mahasannidhanam never allowed wastages to happen. Never in his life. He goes, something goes a wastage, you would reprimand. Because you can't, as human beings, you can't afford to waste. A nail was found somewhere in the Peetam. He requested one of his Shishyas, keep this nail on the sill of the window. And the nail was lodged on the sill. When some package had to be sent to Bangalore, they required one nail. And he said, send to Shishya, there is one nail waiting in the sill, bring it back. Lodged it, used it. See, these instances should, these are very simple instances, should instill how much care and guidance we get from a Jivan Mukta. The last two lectures we saw intensely how he evolved from a brahmachari to a sannyasi and a sannyasi to a yogi. But that yogi spent 55 years of his life post his attainment of a Jivan Mukta dealing these mundane things for the benefit of his shishyas. Somebody wrote something on a paper, and when he was about to present, it all fell down into pieces. It went here and there. Ajahn said, slowly collect it and give it. And he said, why did you write just one sentence in a paper and another sentence in another paper? Why are you not writing it on the reverse side? Simple things to a shishya. When Chandramoulisara Thotti was revamped or restructured, as Acharya used to say then, it seems, his senior Acharya, sun shines during summer and rain rains during the monsoon inside the Chandramouli Thotti. So he wanted to restructure it. He ensured the granite, the stones which were culled out, which found was excess, was utilized in building the Adhishtanam of the 33rd and 34th Acharyas. And his Acharya senior has said that these iron gridder structures should not change. It should remain intact. So he called one of the Shishyas who was in the bank and said, can you find out similar such girders so that we can replace it? I don't want to convert this into RC because that was not the desire of my guru. So the Shishya said, this is age old. You can't get it in this gauge and this weight. It's not possible. Jeshta Mahasannidhanam said, you try. You try for yourself. So the man comes, he's a bank manager. He goes on an inspection to a particular place of his client because he has advanced loans. As he was doing the inspection, the man just pulled out a sheet and found out very old girders there. And he said, will this match? Then he took, this manager took all the dimensions before he left Shingeri. He went to, he said, this may be available either in the Mysore Palace or it may be available at the Bangalore railway station, but it was not there. Suddenly, he found out these girders, 10 of them matched the length. It was brought. And he, once it was built, Jeshta Mahasannidhanam has said, I'm very happy that I have fulfilled the desire of my guru because he didn't want this to change. Small things. How you impress your guru on your day-to-day life. Instances which are absolutely very minimal. Something which we can easily imbibe and practice in our life so that we have that connectivity with our guru. Ocean of compassion. The book says, all of us who had been in the Sachidananda Vilas before coming to Guru Bhavanam, Acharya used to step out of the door, walk to the left, and then sit in the Peetam and then give us Tirtha Prasadam and also Bhiksha Prasadam, everything. On one fine day, when Jeshta Mahasannidhanam stepped out of the door, he didn't go and sit. He stood in front of the door just opposite to Sachidananda Vilas gate and started to distribute Tirtha Prasadam, started to distribute Bhiksha Prasadam. Nobody understood why. Finally, when almost all the shishyas have gone, one shishya with a helping hand, he was lame. With a helper, he was trying to struggle and climb Sachidananda Vilas. Jyeshtha Mahanisanatanam sent word through to his attendant, asked him to wait there. I was waiting for this shishya to come. Walks down, goes and gives him the prasadam there and said, I was waiting only for you. The kind of small things, how they look at life. Jyeshtha Mahanisanatanam has repeatedly said, never distinguish between something small or something big. There is nothing called big and small. Whatever comes your way, whatever you have to do it in a focused way. You can show 30% focus because it is irrelevant. You can show 50% focus because slightly relevant. You have to show 75% focus because more relevant. There's nothing like that in life. When a lady, in fact, a couple in Gopichetty Palayam, is a very leading doctor. And suddenly he died. So when Jyeshtha Mahasannidhanam was camping in Gopichetty Palayam, this lady prayed, I'm alone. Can I come and relocate myself in Shingeri and spend rest of my life? Acharal thought for a while and blessed her. If that is your wish, may it happen. That lady bequeathed whatever she had to Shingeri Math. She didn't keep anything with her. She gave everything to Acharyal and the Math and came to Shingeri. She was staying there for a while outside the temple, outside the campus. And one fine day when Jyeshtha Mahasannam came out of the Sharada temple, she found this lady sick and coughing. And he told those families which was living in Narasimhavanam, please take care of this lady. She is struggling alone and now she is fallen sick. Finally, the lady gets admitted to the hospital in Sharda Dharmantri Hospital of Armat. And she was almost sinking. In those days, Jyeshtha Mahasannidhanam used to visit the hospital quite frequently. Whenever he desired, he will go there. And he went there. The lady was not in a position to even lift her head and see. But it was her intense desire that she should somehow see the lotus feet of Acharya. Realizing this, Jyeshtha Mahasannidhanam in that small room ensured what best is possible to expose that visibility which that lady Sishya wished and blessed her and came out. And he went on a tour. This lady collapsed after a while. When the information was conveyed to Jyeshtha Mahasannidhanam, he said two things. Normally, it's human nature to keep everything to yourself till the last. And finally write a will that after my demise, let it go to Shingeri Math. It's quite natural for anybody to do that. Whereas this devotee, in her lifetime, before moving into Shingeri, gave everything to the Math. So, who else can take care of her other than the Math? And two, he conveyed to the attendants, she is just like Sabari. She knows nothing other than her guru's feet. And when she was struggling to even raise her head to have a darshan of my feet, I ensured that she has it finally. Aval ambal padathe poi adayattum appa. That was the blessing he gave to that lady. Compassion. Now take the example when Subbaramayya, one of the earnest devotees of that time to Jyeshtha Mahasannidhanam, he always aspired for Guru Paduka. He has also expressed it a few times. So when Jyeshtha Mahasannidhanam came to his graha, after the puja was over, when everybody left the place, the Sishya found the pair of padukas of Jyeshtha Mahasannidhanam lying in the house. So he took it, went back and placed it before Jyeshtha Mahasannidhanam to say, "You have left it in my house." He said, "You always wanted up my padukas, so I have left it for you. It's meant only for you." So the Sishya was very happy and he retained it. But whenever Acharya came to Bangalore, he always, after that, requested Acharya should come to my house. For which Acharya replied, "I am already there in the padukas." So the message that every Sishya should understand, absolutely there is no distinction between Guru and Guru's padukas. I'll give you one instance which happened in the life history of a Sishya when she prayed for Jyeshtha Mahasannidhanam's paduka. She has been in Shringeri for quite a long time. And when she finally got married, she had to move out of Shringeri. So she was virtually crying that I need to go, but this is my necessity. So Jyeshtha Mahasannidhanam, out of compassion, gave her a paduka and said, "This paduka will ensure my presence with you always. Take it." So she takes it. She took it and came back and settled near Bangalore. And it's her nature, whenever she has a trouble, whenever she wants a solution or a resolution to an issue, she will put chits on the padukas. And whatever it indicates, she will follow it. Her husband was working in a private company. This is something around 77, 76, 77, during that period. And he was drawing some 4,000 rupees salary. So he got a call in LIC Bangalore, Mumbai, for an interview. So, and the job offered him a pay scale of 25,000 rupees in those days, 50 years back. So he, like any other middle class family, the couple were interested that he should go to the interview and secure it. This lady somehow had a hunch. She said, "Why not I pray to Acharya and find out what his desire is?" And she places the chits on the padukas of Acharya, and he declined, said, "Let him not go to the interview." So she mustered lot of strength to convey this to her husband, to say that this is what I get and I need to convey it to you, then I leave it to you. The man actually is puzzled. Original. At first stage, he got puzzled. Second stage, he got confused. And third stage, he was slightly angry also. He said, "Whenever you seek something in the paduka, Acharya always helps you. When you find it for me, he doesn't help me." Usual reaction. So he wanted to go and he couldn't go. He was stuck. And this lady was about to deliver a child. So her parents had come. And they were planning to go to Shringeri that night via Shimoga. So the plan was, this man had to attend the interview, fly down to Bangalore, reach the station and say bye to his wife. That was the plan. But after all, he's not going now. So he took his family, his wife and father-in-law, mother-in-law, all to the station. And the 9 o'clock English news declared that the flight which he was supposed to fly crashed. So he rushed to Shringeri and he said, "You have saved my life." The message is, if you have faith, intense faith, between, you need not differentiate between Acharya in the physical form as distinct from Acharya's padukas. Whatever you aspire, whatever you pray, whatever you wish, whatever is good for you will get conveyed praying before the padukas. Mahasannidhanam has always said, always pray. Whenever you have a paduka at your house, imagine that I am resting on it, I am standing on it. We can do the worship in that form. When it comes to Shaktipada, which we have talked about in the two earlier episodes, talks, Shaktipada is a divine energy, a bliss. A Jivan Mukta can pass it on to any Shishya to show bliss. Any Shishya means deserving Shishya. In the earlier talks, we have seen how his experience of Kundalini was shown, and a similar experience Sri Umesh Ji had there. He said, because Umesh Ji asked a question, did it take 30 minutes for all this to happen? He said, no, it took only 5 minutes, less than 5 minutes. And he said, sit down. He held his hand and he experienced it. And he confirmed what he experienced and said, you have experienced it. And it all took less than 3.5 minutes. The entire experience of Kundalini. So, this is a divine power. A Jivan Mukta can always share it to his Shishyas. So, a question arose. After all, you have the Shaktipada. Why don't you turn every Shishya into a good Shishya? For which Jyeshtha Mahasannidhanam replied, yes, it is possible. But you must remember, I can use my Shaktipada and then give bliss to a devotee. On the strength of it, he will get some experiences. He will get the inclination to do meditation for a while. But he cannot sustain on it because he is otherwise not a material capable enough to receive the Shaktipada. Sustenance. So, why doesn't Acharya bless us? Why does that man get a better? No. Who are we to ask? A doctor knows the patient better. Which medicine can be administered to which patient? Only a doctor knows. So I say sustenance is a challenge. If you survive that sustenance and struggle to hold on it, there is a possibility for adverse interferences to happen in our material life, which all of us face because we still have a cling to the material life. And he says, if you start doing it, it leads you to more and more of frustration. Situation worsens. And therefore, Jyeshtha Mahasannidhanam says, conveying a Shaktipada is not difficult for a guru. But unless somebody has the foundational strength, how do you expect an acharya to build a superstructure over it? Will it stand? Now, slowly I want to transgress and get into a few episodes on the yogic power. That's when we talk about Jyeshtha Mahasannidhanam, we are always referred to him as a yogi. Inexplicable, mystical, the mystery of unraveling so many things in so many different ways, which sometimes looks very, very difficult to even believe, which we saw in the two earlier episodes in Vande Guru Paramparam, a few more from this book and elsewhere also. The conveyance of good to his Shishyas through a yogic power. He visits a place in Kerala, a family, and the family takes Acharyal to their family deity, Balamba. So when Acharyal visits that place, he sees something strange and says, please remove this a little. You will find a blanket tail. There won't be a tile beneath it. Just open it. So the family who has been doing worshipping this Lord for quite some time were puzzled, and they said, okay, we'll do it, because Acharya has said, when they move it, they found out a tile missing. Acharya has said, one of your family members has attained Siddhi in this very place on which the statue has been installed. You should perform Aradhanai henceforth for this sannyasi who earlier belonged in the Purvashrama, belonged to your family. The family was stuck with this information, which they received for the first time. He goes to a place called Vatrai. This is an episode reported when somebody wrote about the Chandragiri hills of Vatrai. And this has been taken as a source in getting incorporated in the multifaceted Jivan Mukta book. He goes to Vatrai. Acharyal camps. After the night Chandramoulisura Puja, he looks up at the Mahalingeshwara temple. on the Chandragiri Hills. Midnight, he walks alone. Stays there for a while. Looks at the temple, returns back and tells his Sishya, tomorrow morning, 10 o'clock, I need to go there. So a visit is arranged. So one person accompanies Acharya. He visits the first Shiva temple. Then he goes to the second, one more at a higher altitude, beyond which the attendant or the person who came, he couldn't do climb that fast. He went still higher. At one point of time, Jyeshtha Mahasannidhanam disappeared into the forest. And the person who accompanied him could not go inside. And he waited for a while. He just waited for a while and he didn't know what to do. So after a while, he slowly climbed on a tree. From there, he saw a sight. Jyeshtha Mahasannidhanam conversing with one more sannyasi. It's all there in the book. The source is somebody wrote an article on Chandragiri Hills and they have documented this episode, which is reflected in Multifaceted Jivan Mukta. Then he climbs down. Once he climbs down, he never spoke to anybody. He goes back. This Sishya who accompanied the Swami Acharya was a resident of Atrayat. So when other sannyasis came, he narrated the incident to him. This is what I witnessed. For which the sannyasi has said, he is a Siddha Purusha in Chandragiri Hills who is otherwise not visible to anybody. Because Jyeshtha Mahasannidhanam is a yogi, they could sit and converse with each other. This is how this book records this episode. Now go to the third one, something to do with our village. All of us would have seen a Sishya so working so well and sincerely for the past 1.5-2 decades at Sringeri. This is about him. When he was born and just a few months child, Jyeshtha Mahasannidhanam visited Melmangalam and he went on a house camp, including their house. So when he was inquiring about everybody there in the house, this small child, few months old, somehow clutched the holy divine hands of Jyeshtha Mahasannidhanam. And Jyeshtha Mahasannidhanam did not resist it. So when he was about to leave, he just touched the tile on his head and went. Their parents worked, his father worked in different places across India and he was traveling here and there. The child still grew from strength to strength and became extremely competent in material knowledge. But he always had a bhavane and believed in the tenets of Bhagavad Gita. One fine day, Jagadguru Srimad Chandrasekhara Bharati Mahaswamikal came in his dream and said, what are you doing? You should go to Sringeri. So he went to Sringeri and narrated this incident to Mahasannidhanam, saying, this is what I experienced. I do not know whether it's a dream or a hallucination or I'm imagining something else. Mahasannidhanam thought for a while and said, no, it's not a dream. It's a dream, but not unreal. What you heard, what you saw is a blessing for you. You should come to Sringeri. And good fortune, now the family, his parents are also in Sringeri. People who are traveling across, couldn't stay in a place beyond a few years, or no permanent abode is Sringeri. And look at the good fortune of this gentleman. He had the divine vision of Jagadguru Srimad Chandrasekhara Bharati Mahaswami. He had the divine touch of Jagadguru Srimad Abhinava Vidyadita Mahaswami. And he had the upadesam that you should do what in life from Mahasannidhanam Jagadguru Shishi Bharati Tirtha Mahaswamigal. And he proudly claims, fourth generation Acharyal, I am also now serving Sannidhanam Jagadguru Shishi Vidushekhara Bharati Mahaswamigal. 4 generations. And he's less than 50 years old. This is the type a Sishya can experience the yogic power of Acharya. A lady now who is in US, when I was writing these episodes in 2019, she spoke to me I have something to share about Jyeshtha Mahasannidhanam. Can I do it? I said, please do share. She was then at Bangalore and coming from a middle class family. And she was desirous of pursuing education, whereas the family was very particular that she should get married. And in fact, someone came forward and said, we will marry your daughter. And you don't worry about any resources. All of that we will manage. We have plenty. Please give your daughter in marriage. So the family was deeply interested to get her married. And those were days, 50 years back, it's not so easy for a girl or a lady to stand up and say that this is what I want in life. So she was very confused. And they all went to Shringeri to convey this message that there is a proposal coming and they wanted to go ahead and they want to take a blessing. So she was standing on the queue. This is what she told me, and I've written it also in a set of 130 episodes. This is one of the episodes. So she was standing on the queue for darshanam. And she only prayed to Acharya, I cannot speak my voice now because my parents are there. It's very difficult to put my desire to you. But you are a Sarvajnan, you know everything. This is the hint I'm going to take for myself. If you give me an apple, it means that I have to agree to my family's choice and marry him. If you give me an orange, then I will take it as a sign that I can now stand up and resist that you don't want this marriage to happen. This is the only way I can take a divine direction with you without speaking to you. Because I can't speak in front of my parents. So this is what was going ahead, going in her mind as she was walking, slowly progressing in the queue. And when she reached the divine holy feet of Acharya, Acharya looked at her, smiled and gave her an orange. And she therefore declined the marriage. And she conveyed to me, after a few years, the man whom they had proposed originally actually died. So, how Acharya saved me from a peril in life. We all want, at some point of time as shishyas, we all aspire for a mantra japa. One fine day, Jyeshtha Mahasannidhanam appeared in the dream of a lady who had 5 daughters, a son, and said, keep singing Sri Chakra Raja. It's a very famous Tamil song which all of us in our childhood we sing gloriously. Simhasaneshwari, Sri Lalitambikai. You sing this. When she understood this dream and she perceived it as real and started to sing this to her heart's content as many million times as possible. After a few years, she goes to Shringeri and prays to Acharya, you must give me a mantropadesam. For which Jyeshtha Mahasannidhanam said, I have already given you the mantropadesam, Sri Chakra Rajanil. Start singing, continue to sing that. This prayer of yours will bring prosperity to your family, to your children. They will all be well placed in life. All the 5 daughters got married. The son is well placed. And she's 88 or 89 when this episode was written 3 years back, conveying that I continue to sing it sincerely. So mantra jabam need not necessarily mean, each one has different prescriptions. For one, she assumed Jyeshtha Mahasannidhanam's Dhyana Sloka as a mantra. Vivekinam Mahaprikyam Dairodhara Chamanidim Sadabhinavapurvantam Vidyatita. She used to chant it 1,000 times. Thousands and thousands of times. People around her, friends who were around her, when they had some difficulty, they used to call her on a phone and say, please chant this for us. She goes to Shringeri and prays to Mahasannidhanam, I want a mantropadesam. For which Mahasannidhanam has said, I have already conveyed this in your dream. Continue with the Dhyana Sloka, that's your mantropadesam. Yogic power. You don't have to necessarily communicate anything and everything at every point of time. See the episodes, plenty of them gives us a relationship, the divine relationship between an acharya and a sishya. A very important episode on the yogic power of Jyeshtha Mahasannidhana. A couple attended the darshanam of Jyeshtha Mahasannidhana every day. And when they were about to leave from the darshanam, they would consistently pay with Jyeshtha Mahasannidhana, "You should come to my house and give us a darshanam there." So Mahasannidhana at some point of time assured, "I will come to your house before I leave this camp." And the last day came. So the couple were weeping before him. So Jyeshtha Mahasannidhana inquired, "Why are you unhappy? Are you unhappy that I am going to leave this camp?" For which they conveyed, the couple conveyed, "Yes, that's true that we will feel unhappy that you are going away from us. But what is even more bothering us is you had promised to come, but you didn't come. So it's disappointing for us." So Jyeshtha Mahasannidhana clarified, "What did I say? I said, I will come to your house. How do you say that I have not kept my promise? No, you have not come to our house." Then Jyeshtha Mahasannidhana says, "On a particular day, I visited your house. I visited your house midnight. You were sleeping here. Your children were sleeping here. This is your hall size. This was what was kept on the dining table. This is your puja room. These are the pictures which you have hung in your puja room." He narrates the entire order. "So I had been there. I've seen your puja room. I've seen all the divine pictures which you have hung. I saw all of you. I have come back." The couple were stunned. "So I never promised. I said I'll come to your house. Did I promise I'll visit your house? You'll do pada puja. I will give you a darshanam in your house. Did I say anything?" "I said I will come to your house. I have kept my promise." What is that? See, we should understand the concept. How is this possible? See, because science comes here. How is this possible? I need to therefore dwell on it a few minutes. What is the time? Okay, another 10 minutes I have? 10 more minutes. Okay, fine. We'll wind up. See, what do we mean by a Jivan Mukta? One who has attained bliss. One who has conquered this body, this mind, this buddhi, everything, and remains completely in isolation of this body. One who has realized himself during his lifetime in this body is a Jivan Mukta. Once you become a Jivan Mukta, there is no difference. We have always said this many a time. There is no difference between Brahman, Ishwaran and Jiva, a realized Jiva. The difference between us and a Jivan Mukta is we are also Jivas, but we are not realized souls. Whereas a Jivan Mukta is one who is a realized soul. That's the difference. And the difference is huge. A realized soul is equivalent to Ishwaran and Brahman. Now, whether it is Brahman or Ishwaran or a Jivan Mukta, once you reach bliss and become a realized soul, there are no constraints. Because there is no constraint in terms of time. There is no constraint in terms of space. And there is no constraint in terms of substance or causation. See, the difference between a Jiva and a Ishwara. Ishwara can create. Jiva cannot create. Even though both are one and the same. Because we are bound by Maya, whereas he is a controller of Maya. It's the difference. in terms of Vedantic understanding. So one who transcends from being a slave of Maya to a master of Maya, once he transcends that zone and attains bliss, then that soul, even though is in a human frame like us, is not a human being or a mere jiva. That's why we call them as jivan muktas. And for a jivan mukta, there is absolutely no constraints. Like, does Brahman have a constraint? This universe is created by Brahman through the potency called Maya. It's not just this universe, the 14 lokas. How is it possible? It's illusion. Like a big bang, you can suck it 1 minute and you can bring it back any number of times. It's easy for Brahman to do it. We all know that. We have read Veda. Those who have read Veda and who have listened to lectures, we understand and appreciate this. When Brahman can do, Jivan Mukta can also do. Because there is no difference between Brahman, Ishwaran and Jivan Mukta. Absolutely no difference. And therefore, when Acharyal says, I have come to your house, I have seen everything around and started to catalog what is inside your house just to ensure that the couple understands and feels whatever he says is true. Jivan Muktas don't have constraints. And yogic power is just a miniature vehicle for them to do whatever they wish to do good. You have pleased a devotee who is pious, a devotee who has faith, a devotee who wants to come, who wants Acharyal to come to their dwelling. So Acharyal says, as a Jivan Mukta, I can travel. Acharyal says, my padugas are not different from me. So what more does a Sishya need? A very interesting episode, a very intricate, intense episode about the Adhishthanam of Jyeshtha Mahasannidhan. Somebody's wedding day is on 6th June 1989. She visits Sringeri because her wedding day. And she converses with her elder sister, and her elder sister says, you should pray for a paduka. Then the younger sister says, I mean, two small children. I can't maintain that much of cleanliness and purity. I dare not to pray at this point of time. This conversation is watched by Jyeshtha Mahasannidhan. So he calls them and says, what were you talking? So the elder sister says, I'm only requesting her to pray for a paduka. Acharya says, okay, I'll give you the paduka. Blesses the paduka for the younger sister. This happens in June 1989. So the younger sister aspired, after all, Acharya has blessed us a paduka. So we should now offer a paduka to Jyeshtha Mahasannidhan. So request her mother and her elder sister who were staying at Sringeri to find out the carpenter of those days, the famous Narayanan. When you give your order today, he'll give it after a few years. That's what people say. You have to chase him to get it done. Finally makes a paduka. So they take this paduka and goes for the darshanam of Jyeshtha Mahasannidhan a week before. When they go and then offer it, Jyeshtha Mahasannidhan saw the paduka and gave it back. Then the lady, the mother and the daughter said, no, sister has offered it only for you. So Jyeshtha Mahasannidhan asked the question, idu enaka? Is it for me? So they said, yes, it is for you. Then he takes it. Then he adorns it. He wears it, walks a few steps. Appa seri, idha nane vechukuren. It's okay, fine. I will retain it to myself. Then was about to open the door and then walk inside. Sachidananda Vilas, all of you remember how it will be. Was about to step into. Turns back. இது எப்போது என்கிட்டயே இருக்கட்டும். Let this remain always with me. And a few days later, Jyeshtha Mahasannidhanam attains Siddhi. So, when the Adhishthanam was under, when they were preparing the Adhishthanam there, Mahasannidhanam, after placing the linga, called for a padukas to be placed at the adhishtanam. So they bring this paduka and place it in the adhishtanam. The mother and the elder daughter is witness to this scene. They said, they confirmed me over phone when I wrote this episode that this is the very paduka we offered, which is placed at the adhishtanam. As a lawyer, I probed. I said, how do you say that this is the same paduka? Because padukas will be, there will be replicas of it. How do you ascertain that this is the paduka you had given? And the lady very nicely replied, we offered this paduka made out of jackfruit tree. So it had a dim, pale, yellowish color over it. And therefore, when we offered it, we found that color, dim, yellowish color on the padukas. And therefore, it resembled and we thought that it is arpa. But look at the words. இது எனக்கேவா, இது என்கிட்டயே இருக்கட்டும், இது எப்போதும் என்கிட்டயே இருக்கட்டும். A words of a ஜீவன் முக்தா can never ever go wrong. In anybody's life, there must be a reason. We have to wait. For some, it happens immediately. For some, it happens after a while. But in their lifetime, they will understand and experience what those words really mean to them. At some point of time, it has to get addressed. Nobody will be left unaddressed if they have presented their point of view with absolute faith. Look at this incident. One last two incidents and then we'll close it. A lady who was in Shingeri, for several years the couple did not have a child. And they finally were blessed with a child. And she delivered the child at the Sharada Dhanvantri hospital. And like usual visit, Cheshta Mahasannidhanam was making a visit on that day. It was the intense desire of that lady that somehow Cheshta Mahasannidhanam should see the child. And she has conveyed it to somebody who conveyed it to me. That I know it is impossible. It's a maternity room. So I can't expect this to happen. But the desire was so longing in me. I'm just talking in terms of yogic power. So she kept on praying against an impossibility that somehow Cheshta Mahasannidhanam should give a darshanam to her child. As Cheshta Mahasannidhanam was walking back after going around the hospital, as he crossed, is what is written in that episode, the door opens automatically. And Cheshta Mahasannidhanam did not stand and look, fleeting glance on the child. The lady records it. He showered a fleeting glance on my child, which is what I aspired. I didn't aspire Acharya should see me. No, I wanted only my child to be. It opened for a second, a fleeting glance at the sight of the child, and they started moving out. We can keep multiplying any number of episodes. In fact, there was a request from many Sishyas outside Chennai that we would like this talk to be filled with episodes. That was a request. So that's why I filled, because next Saturday and Sunday, we are speaking a virtual on for Shingeri Guru Bandhava channel for Jnananda Bharati's Swamigal's Jayanti. 2 days I'm going to talk on thoughts of Gita, completely a scientific approach of Bhagavad Gita. On he puts 7 steps to show to people why God should be believed and proves the existence of God in 140 pages. So we're going to do that talk next Saturday, Sunday. So many of our friends asked, we should fill it with a lot of episodes. That's why we decided this talk should only be filled with episodes. This is the final episode with which we wind up. Ingratitude is an incurable sin, says the Spitam and its Acharyas. Repeatedly in every Anugraha Bhashanam, Acharyas have said, you should never forget what somebody has done to you. And you should immediately forget what you have done to somebody. These are 2 corollaries. What you do, you should forget immediately. What is done to you, you should never forget in your life. And see the way they show their divine gratitude to those shishyas who had worked with them, who have served the Peetham selflessly. Three instances with that we wind up. S.G. Narasimhaiya was a private secretary to Jagatguru Srimad Chandrasekhara Bharati Mahaswamigal. He was 91 years. He was in Bangalore, in Malleshwar. One fine day he decided, when his daughter, much against his daughter's will, he wanted to come back to his house for a while. She said, because at 91, which child will leave her parents to be alone? So, but he said, no, I'm going back. So he came back to his house and he was resting at around 11:30, 12. Jeshtamaha Sannidhanam, after finishing a trip, when he was returning back, requested the driver to drive to Malleshwaram. He said, I want to go and see Narasimhaiya. Suddenly, Ganapati Avadani, my mama, driver and Jeshtamaha Sannidhanam. And the driver did not know the place. Jeshtamaha Sannidhanam guided him back to reach. That family spoke to us when we wrote this episode. This family member spoke. He guided them to reach his house. And Avadani mama came and woke Narasimhaiya and said, Jeshtamaha Sannidhanam has come. He's going to enter your house in the next one. At 91 years, he couldn't understand anything. It took some time for him to realize that he's going to receive Jeshtamaha Sannidhanam. The happiness is Acharya is coming. The unhappiness is his unpreparedness. So both, it's like oscillating pendulum. Both, he was between the both. Narasimhaiya, I wanted to come and see you because I understood that you are not well. People told me you're not well. I wanted to come and bless you. Then he says, I'm not able to perform Pada Puja even. Why do you worry? The seva you have done to Acharya, the seva you have done to the Peetham, the seva you have done for the Shivaganga, for the establishment of the Shivaganga Mat, it's all there in the history. I came here only to bless you. And he goes. The second instance is in the life history of Bhashya Swamihal, who has again done so much for Jagatguru Srimad Chandrasekhara Bharati Mahaswamihal. If we know something about Jagatguru Srimad Chandrasekhara Bharati Swamihal, it's only because of Bhashya Swamihal's writings. So, when Acharya, he spent his last days in Mahadhanapuram. So, when Jeshtamaha Sannidhanam went for a camp to Mahadhanapuram, he was carried in the golden palanquin with the darbar dress. That was the protocol at that point of time. So as the procession was progressing, it suddenly rained. Just opposite to the Tirtha Vinayakar temple in Mahadhanapuram, where Bhashya Swamihal was camping, was staying. It was his abode. So it was raining. All of us know when a deity is taken on a procession, you start and end in the same place where you started. You don't halt it in the middle. Jeshtamaha Sannidhanam says, stop. Gets out of the palanquin, touches the divine things placed before Acharya, walks into the Tirtha Vinayakar, Purnakumbam. He touches the Purnakumbam, walks inside to Tirtha Vinayakar Kovil and says, and invites Bhashya Swamigal inside. Disrobes himself. Peetham is put. He sits on the Peetham and starts conversing with Bhashya Swamihal. The service Bhashya Swamihal has rendered to the mutt is immense. So Bhashya Swamihal was perplexed. He said, you are in the middle of a procession. How did you break? It's a breach of a tradition, and why did you do this to me? For which Jeshtamaha Sannidhanam said, no, Swamihal, it rained. Therefore, I had to break. For which Bhashya Swamihal replied, no, it did not rain. You brought the rain. For which Jeshtamaha Sannidhanam said, how do you say this rained? Because who is here? Tirtha Vinayagar is here. So it rained. So I came inside because it rained. Bhashya Swamihal replies, no, it is Vidya Tirthar along with Tirtha Vinayagar who brought it, and therefore you have come only to bless me. Swamihal, Acharya smiled at Bhashya Swamihal. I wanted to come and bless you. And this is the way I can do for you. And leaves. Gratitude. And the last one is, I started with Jnananda Bharati Swamihal, how avatars. I want to conclude because it happens to be his Jayanti day today. Before Jnananda Bharati Swamihal departed, you should read his small book of life history. See, he attained Siddhi on 9th April 1975. In his book, he has written his departure date 1 year ahead, 1974. Same paksham, same tithi. Only difference is from Chitrai to Panguni. Panguni to Chitrai. That's the only difference. Masi to Panguni. But when he filled those dates, year, he left a blank and put it in pencil. He should have departed in 1974. Jyeshtha Mahasannidhanam retained his life for 1 year because 11th November 1974, Jyeshtha Mahasannidhanam did the Sushya Shikaram of our present Mahasannidhanam. And when he did his first camp to Tamil Nadu to visit Rameshwaram, 2nd February 1975, both of them go to Mannadi Mangalam in person because at that point of time, Jnananda Bhai Swamil just could not even get up from his chair. People who have witnessed it, I've spoken about it in the Adhishtana in one of the lectures. I'm just putting it in a condensed form. So, both Acharyas, Mahasannidhanam and Sannidhanam, at that point of time, now Jyeshtha Mahasannidhanam and Mahasannidhanam went and he said the following words, I wanted to show Sishya Swamihal to you. And that's why I've come here to Mannadi Mangalam. The immense selfless services done by Jnananda Bhatti Swamigal is something which all of us know. Stayed there for an hour or more. And when Jyeshtha Mahasa, when Jnananda Bhatti Swamigal wanted to have a particular form of physical worship of Jyeshtha Mahasannidhanam, he decided, this is how I want to pray. Jyeshtha Mahasannidhanam, understanding it, ensured that he gives that divine form of blessing and appearance to Jnananda Bhatti Swami. It says, it's very difficult to explain it, what it is. It's so unique that just to fulfill his wish, Jyeshtha Mahasannidhanam breached a protocol just for his Sishya Swami because of his selfless, dedicated service to this matter. So, may it be Bhashya Swamigal, may it be Jnananda Bhatti Swamigal, may it be Narasimhayya, these are all Sishyas who are born like us and dedicated their services, their mind, their resources, their happiness, their joy, everything in the selfless service of the Math. And this is how the Pitadipati of the Math recognizes it. What someone has done to you, don't forget. What you have done to someone, forget it immediately. What you have done to someone, forget it immediately. I think we can keep saying a lot of things, any number of lectures. We can do a saptaham on multifaceted Jeevan Mukta alone. That book is an encyclopedia on Jyeshtha Mahasannidhanam. And all of us should remind, in fact, Mahasannidhanam should bless us one opportunity that we should speak one lecture on how Sri Umesh Ji has authored this book, how he has taken the gems from various perspectives, how he has built such a fine necklace because it has 25, 27 chapters ranging from the most pristine Vedantic truth and approach to sublime, ordinary material benefits which Acharya has granted to please his Sishyas. The bandwidth is so huge. And this is one book involving three great souls. It's a book on Jyeshtha Mahasannidhanam. It's a book validated by Mahasannidhanam. And it's a book authored by Sri Umeshi. So, would request all the devotees to download it and read it at least once. And it's like Bhagavad Gita. It's like any other text. The reason, every time you read it after a gap of few years, when you read the same story, it gives you a different dimension. It shows you either you have evolved or you have not evolved. It shows you both. That's the power of this book. And I would request all of you to download it and read it. 2 pages, 3 pages, one is very small chapters, very small episodes. Read it whenever you can, daily for a few minutes. And in 1 year's time, you can complete it. 6 months' time, you can complete it, depending upon your speed, which makes all the difference to all of you. I thank Tathuloka for this great reopening post-COVID. And thank Ramchandra Mama, Sarla Mami, and I honestly expected 4 or 5 people. I'm happy most of the chairs here are full because we are so used to virtual. In fact, I mean, I decline all personal invitations where I have to go do physical in some outside Delhi when I'm there. I prefer to do only virtual. We are all now got into that mode. So happy that so many could respond for our invitation. And we shall be very happy to upload this talk in a while in our channel for the rest of the viewers to enjoy it. And I thank once again Dr. Vasumathi, Tathuloka Mama, and Sarla Mami, and all of you here to have found your time to attend to your physical talk after possibly 1.5 years. And thanks a lot. And looking for more and more blissful opportunities to speak about this Avichinna Guru Parampara and this Avichinna Sishya Parampara. Sadashiva Samarambam Shankaracharya Madhyamam Asmat Acharya Pariyantam Vande Guru Parampara. Thank you so much. Peace.